Welcome to the audiobook, Neurology Rounds with the Maverick. Adventures with Patients from the Golden Age of Medicine. Written by Bernard M. Patten, M.D. Narrated by Gregory V. Diehl. Produced by Identity Publications. General Conversation with the Reader. Some years ago, never mind how many, I gave a silver dollar to Shay Mia Patten, my granddaughter, who ran wide-eyed and skipping to her daddy and asked, "What is this?" He told her, "That is a coin of a bygone era." For some time, Craig's statement bothered my sleep, but now I know it is true, and not only that, I know I am from a bygone era, an era when life was quite different. An era that included what is now considered by doctors as the Golden Age of Medicine. It was an interesting time for doctors because there were few administrators. The insurance companies did not interfere with medical practice, and, believe it or not, money was not a big issue. There was less technology, so doctors relied on, had to rely on, taking a history and doing a physical examination, both of which gave close contact with their fellow human beings who were patients. In the Golden Age, physicians became involved in the stories of their patients' lives, sometimes as witnesses and most times as players. It was a time when doctors knew their fellow creatures better than most men, knew the inner life which so seldom unfolds itself to unanointed eyes and ears. It was a time when medicine was a calling, not a job. My own life, by being close to patients, by knowing their psychology deeply, has been entwined with patient lives and their stories. Thus, this is not my memoir alone, but a memoir of the people I have known. One of the great benefits to a medical career is you get an endless fund of stories, some funny, some terrible, but all real. The narrated events displayed in this book are true. They are a selected part of my curriculum vitae. They are not based on true events. They are the true events. If you are looking for fiction, you are reading the wrong book. Go watch TV. Though this book is part of the literature of fact, there are no composite or made-up characters, nothing isn't real or didn't happen, the names of some patients, as a courtesy, have been changed. But in the record about the breast implants, where there were problems aplenty, all the names are those of real people, and all the events happened, including the raid on my laboratory, the death threats, the assault of Trent, my chauffeur, the beheaded rabbit at the doorstep, and the arson that burned down my nurse's home. Part of even the most normal of us pass during our lives into a weird haunted chamber. My haunted chamber was the medical research on breast implants. In that haunted chamber, I became the classic historian, because I was there, and I lived through the horrors and the mess. The ladies who suffered from breast implants deserve to have their stories generally known, and that is exactly what I shall do in part 3 of this book. So, if you continue to read, you will get a decentralized story, a narration of events in time, morally, and otherwise floating like a balloon over hullabaloo. Here you will see, and I hope actually experience, scenes of joy, sorrow, suffering, disease, ordeal, and triumph. The real-life adventures of taking care of very sick people, the bummer of getting involved with malpractice lawsuits, as well as the battles entailed by standing up to corporate America in the matter of the safety and effectiveness of breast implants. As a physician, I took an oath to not only take care of the individual patient, but to also protect the public health. Fighting powerful interests such as insurance companies and medical device manufacturers can mean being viewed as a weirdo, an outsider. That's the downside, but one that you have to be willing to accept. Attention! Why you should read this book. Knowledge of the coming facts and events should bring you a sense and perception of a life and a world you might not have otherwise been familiar with. You may even be motivated to help make things improve. So step up. Increase the intensity and range of your experience. Use this memoir as a source of knowledge to examine and clarify your life, the lives of others, and life in general. In the end, Decide for yourself if it is better for a doctor to function at the junction of art and science and practice medicine not as a stranger, or is it better for a doctor to enter the survival mode, knuckle under, and muddle through as many burned-out physicians are doing right now, as your own doctor, much to your detriment, may be doing right now. Decide. Is it better to let your insurance company make medical decisions for you, or better to let your doctor? About the stories. There are a million ways to tell a story. You know there are. One way is chronological. Another way is by topic. Another way is by memory links, as one story suggests or reminds of another. My way is to do all three and let it flow as normal people think most of the time and sometimes sprawl, telling you what's on their minds. And that's that. The approach is sensible and humane. So here I faithfully report to you, dear reader, scenes, events, and adventures in a privileged world that was in intimate contact with the nuance and foibles of human nature. Enough. In the final analysis, it is best to let the memoir speak for itself. That we shall do in the pages that follow. But first, a word of thanks to my wife, Ethel. Her title should be Saint Ethel. She truly loves me and has proved her love by living with me for the last 55 years. It is to her this work is dedicated. She doesn't need to read this book. She lived it. To Ethel. Sine te nihil. When Dr. James D. Watson spoke at the Research Corporation dinner where he was honored for his work on DNA, many in the audience were startled by the account he gave of his career as a scientist. They expected a story of gradual discovery, by orderly experiments and unfolding truths. They were prepared for setbacks of a technical kind, which would retard but also heighten the final triumph. They were not prepared for the red thread of life, which Watson wove into his narrative, the chance meetings and clashing personalities, the haste and envy, the fumbling and idling, in a word, the politics and social vicissitudes of science. Jacques Barzum, Science, the Glorious Entertainment. Record 1. Adventures and Misadventures in the Golden Age of Medicine. So one day in 1988, I was making rounds with the students and residents, and a student presented me the brain tumor in 209. And I said, "Isn't there a child involved in this? Tell me about the child. Tell me about the family. Did you know any of this?" They did not. At home that night, Arnold Gold told his wife of his concerns about where medicine was headed. She told him, "You know, Arnold, I'm tired of you griping about medicine. Do something about it or shut up." Thus, Arnold Gold, pediatric neurologist, made compassionate care a cause and founded the Arnold P. Gold Foundation to inspire young doctors to practice compassionate patient care. On rounds, he wanted doctors to know about the lives of their patients, not just their vital signs, not just the details of the disease afflicting them. Tableau 1. The Kid Who Couldn't Stop Laughing and the Artist Who Was Losing His Mind. Patient Linda, Bayer College of Medicine. Uncontrollable laughing. She was 15 and in high school. Her GP sent her because she was jerked out of French class because she couldn't or wouldn't stop laughing. Was this a seizure disorder or a form of epilepsy? The family physician asked. The laughing started in the schoolyard, in back of the handball court, about halfway into the after-lunch recess. The laughing continued into French class and down at the principal's office. The uncontrolled and uncontrollable laughing stopped at 3:17 p.m. that afternoon. There have been no further episodes. Linda's neurological examination was normal. To the concerned parents, I said, I would like to talk with Linda alone. Please excuse us. Attention, reader. Your diagnosis, please. How would you handle this situation and this patient? How would you handle her family? Still with me? I pause for reply to make sure you are awake and to give you a chance to stretch your mental powers. What caused the uncontrolled laughing? What should be done? Me. Linda, I'm going to let you off this time because I'm a nice guy. But promise me you won't smoke weed before school or at recess. That way you won't embarrass yourself again. Linda. I had never smoked that stuff before, but I didn't want to look like a chicken, so when the blunt came my way, I took a long, deep drag like a regular cigarette. I passed it to Lynette when the weed kicked in, and I couldn't stop laughing. I was laughing so hard I nearly keeled over. Nothing was funny, but I couldn't stop. Me. Okay. Keep your mouth shut while I explain to your parents there's nothing to worry about. You're off the hook, this time. Linda is normal neurologically. Actually, quite intelligent. Linda's father. How do you know? Detailed neurological exam is normal, so I know her nervous system is normal. She has an excellent thought process, fluent speech, and an advanced vocabulary. So I know she's intelligent. The laughing episode will probably never happen again. She doesn't have a seizure disorder, and even if she did, we wouldn't treat her, or anyone for that matter, for a single seizure. If we treated people for a single isolated seizure, 3% of the population of America would be taking seizure medicines. So, no tests, no treatment. Go home and forget it. The high school syndrome. Linda's case is part of a larger syndrome of high school kids asleep in class or drunk. The usual cause is alcohol or drugs. The laughing problem is almost always due to marijuana smoked just before school starts or at recess. Strangely, the laughing fits seem to involve only teenage girls. As far as I know, the syndrome was never written up in the neurology journals. It's too trivial. Experienced neurologists would make the correct diagnosis without much thinking. No tests needed. The diagnosis is secure, as it often is, just from the history alone. George Rodrigue, artist and painter. Subacute dementia. A young artist came to see me because he was losing his mind. He had painted several paintings that had sold for a lot of money, and, though he was young, he already had a national and international reputation for his work. His most famous paintings involved an iconic painting of a blue dog, the shape and stance of which was based on his deceased dog Tiffany and on the Cajun legend of a loup-garou, or werewolf. The problem was over the course of a year, George had noticed a fall-off in his creative abilities, and he had noticed his memory was failing. On more than a few occasions, he would start to say something and then forget what he was talking about. Despite a valiant effort, he just couldn't get back to the subject. Whole evenings would slip out of consciousness, never to be recalled again. This kind of memory deficit is much more serious than ordinary forgetting. It is one thing to forget what you ate for dinner, and quite another thing to forget you had dinner at all. George, I'm going to say three items. Store them in your memory. I will ask you what they were in about 3 minutes. Here's the items. 979 San Lorenzo. National Football League. Jones Beach. George, how much is 3 plus 2? George looks at me as if I'm crazy for asking such a stupid question. 5. That's correct. Now tell me, what were the 3 items I asked you to remember? George shakes his head. Not only does he not recall the items, he doesn't remember my asking him to remember. George, how much is 5 minus 3? George is truly puzzled. He can't say or guess. nor can he do 7 minus 4 or 5 minus 4. George, spell cat. C-A-T. Good. Correct. Now spell cat backward. George looks puzzled. He doesn't get the task, even though I explain in detail cat spelled forward is C-A-T, and I want him to start with the last letter of cat and work backward to the second letter and then the first. Try as he must, he can't do it. Nor can he spell world backward or park. Nor can he tell me whether or not I have spelt those words backward. Why can't he spell backward? Why can't he do the stupid subtractions? Asks his wife. A fair question. The short answer is, we don't know. The long answer is, people with organic brain diseases can't spell simple words backward, and they can't do simple subtractions. Difficulty in doing such tasks is characteristic of memory problems associated with brain damage, particularly damage to the temporal lobes of the brain. And so, dear reader, if you can spell cat backward and subtract 3 from 5, I give it for my opinion as a board-certified neurologist, you are not demented. Not yet. Except for impairment of ability to remember, poor ability to mentally subtract numbers, and inability to spell simple words like cat backward, his neurological examination was okay. Family history, social history, and personal history were okay. Except he was drinking a quart of rye whiskey every night. The brain scan, this was the era of CAT scan, showed a tremendous loss of brain tissue with dilated ventricles, the fluid-filled cavities in the center of the brain, narrow gyri and enlarged sulci. The gyri are brain tissue ridges and the sulci are the valleys between the ridges. Dilated ventricles usually means loss of brain tissue. Narrow gyri, ditto. Enlarged sulci, ditto. Result? The CAT scan showed severe decrease in brain size, presumably due to severe loss of brain tissue itself. Looking at the scan, George, I estimate you have lost over 40% of your brain. That's not good. George looks at the scan and strokes his chin. He is examining the image in great detail, but says nothing. What is he thinking? What? George, the prognosis is not good. In fact, it is grim. Get ready to lose your mind. Make arrangements for your care when you become demented. Prepare while you can. This is frightening, I know, but you have to get things ready and in order. Doc, what's causing the problem? Who knows? Drinking a quart of rye whiskey a day, every day, is probably not helping. Yes, that is what he said he drank, and there is no reason to think he was bragging. If anything, at least according to his wife, he might have been underestimating the dose of booze. A quart of rye whiskey a day would be a big dose even by the standards of my Irish family. It is probably a big dose by Cajun standards as well. If you continue to drink like that, says I, you will soon be dead. Notice I did not say, you must stop drinking. That kind of medical advice is paternalistic and takes part of the patient's personal power away. This man is an adult, and he has to decide what he wants to do with his life. My job, as I saw it at the time, was to give advice in the form of a realistic warning about death. Death is a bad thing, George, I told him. It spoils your weekend. And then to explain the seriousness of the situation, I showed and explained the CAT scan to him in detail. He was impressed by the visual image of his rotted brain, much more impressed by the picture than he was by my warning in words. After all, the man is an artist, a great artist. Pictures spoke to him louder than words, and his pictures spoke to other people louder than words. Then he asked what I thought was a rather naive question. Will my brain grow back? Certainly not. Brain tissue, once lost, is lost forever. The best you may hope for is to arrest the brain loss at the present level. Your brain will never recover, for it never can recover. That is a fact. The brain does not repair itself. Why I Delivered Complete Hokum and Bullshit. At the time, that hokum is what neurologists believed to be true. My advice was right in line with the standard of care for that time and place. Anything less would have been considered wrong by my peers, by the Texas Board of Medical Examiners, and by the American Board of Psychiatry and Neurology. The dogma the brain can't recover was not in a gray zone. It was considered a fact, a piece of received standard wisdom. Irrefutable gospel-level truth. In that era, erroneous ideas were passed, like religious wit, from one generation to another, from one medical article to another. The dogma of the inability of the brain to recover is now passé, part of a bygone era, like myself, and like the silver dollar I gave to Shay Mia Patton, my granddaughter. George was justified not to take my word. He was justified to demand proof his brain would not recover. How do you know for sure my brain can't recover? George, every neurology textbook and every professor of neurology and almost all of the neurologists of my world say so. We must accept the opinion of the authorities. My trouble was I was a victim of conjecture because during medical school, internship, and residency, my professors told me what they thought was fact. So, I continued to try to get this point across by making mere assertions I myself had never even thought to question. I was very dumb in those days. I still am dumb, but not as much. Mark Twain famously said, "It is not what I don't know that hurts. It is all the things I think I know that ain't true." I was sure the brain did not repair itself, as other human organs and human tissues do. But it so happens that ain't true. So, with the time, I continued to feed George bullshit I thought was the truth. Me. Once brain tissue is lost, it can never be recovered. What I did in advising this patient was merely repeat, pull parrot style, the neurological dogma drummed into my head during my medical training. At the time, it was considered no more possible to regenerate brain tissue than it was possible to fly to the moon. Now humans can do both. Also, I know now that reiteration of a mere assertion is not proof of anything. Blindsided by an authority argument. Now I ask for evidence. If the evidence is not relevant and adequate, I will not believe the assertion. It's that simple, and an important lesson. Doubt and skepticism are important parts of thinking like a scientist. In ancient times, when dissections were done, they often showed the teachings of Galenic medicine were wrong. And yet, the evidence was dismissed as accidental or fake. The medical system thus rejected medical science and what Shakespeare called ocular proof as irrelevant. Even in the early days of my medical education, medicine, some of it anyway, was still a branch of theology, wherein you accepted doctrines on faith. A big mistake. Yet another example. When I was an intern, the tradition dictated that patients who had heart attacks had to be placed on concrete bed rest for 4 to 6 weeks to allow the injured heart to repair itself. Sitting in a chair was prohibited. Patients were not allowed to turn from side to side without assistance. The mortality with this treatment was about 35%, with a large number of victims dying from pulmonary embolism. In addition, about 67% of the patients developed frozen shoulders, with swollen red left hands and arms, a condition that greatly impaired the patient's ability to dress. We were told the shoulder-hand syndrome was a reaction of the sympathetic nervous system to the heart attack. Some patients actually got their sympathetic nerves cut on that side without improvement. How did the professors explain the lack of improvement after sympathectomy? They said, "Well, it was just too late." Or they said, "We see it." Never was there any mention of the idea that failure to respond to the operation meant the premise of the operation was an error, and the shoulder-hand problem had nothing whatsoever to do with heart attacks or with the sympathetic nervous system. Complete bed rest also meant no bathroom privileges. Each patient had to use the bedpan, and every time they went to the nurses, they had to move the patient on and off the pan. Nurses also fed the patients 3 times a day. Think of the inconvenience of that and the embarrassment. think of the amount of nursing work involved. When some physicians proposed chair rest, not bed rest, for heart attack victims, the idea met with a dust storm of tremendous resistance from tradition-oriented doctors. Initial studies were not approved by institutional review committees. Nevertheless, some pioneering physicians went ahead. This, remember, was the era wherein the individual doctor had total control of his or her individual patient. Those doctors dared to get their heart attack patients out of bed and into a chair. The results were obvious from the get-go. From the very first patient, chair rest made all the difference. Mortality declined to 10%. Frozen shoulder hand syndrome disappeared completely because it was due to disuse and had nothing whatsoever to do with the sympathetic nervous system or even with the heart attack. Pulmonary embolism became a rare event. Pneumonia from immobilization even became far less frequent. Now we know bed rest is harmful for a number of reasons. It rots bones and weakens muscles. But the worst thing about it, in my view, is the mental and psychological demoralization that comes with remaining in bed 24/7. After all, in America, most of the dying takes place in bed, and there is a sense of safety in being out of bed. Although there has never been, and will never be, a double-blind prospective controlled study comparing bed rest with chair rest for heart attack, chair rest is now the standard of care, and bed rest is not. The way doctors rationalized treatments without merit was draconian, and still troubles my sleep. It is creepy to realize many medical practices are not soundly based, but instead are supported by inertia, fashion, custom, tradition, and undue respect for authority. Long-held belief systems, even when not backed by evidence, become proof of validity and a tremendous impediment to progress. At present, I point the finger of accusation at the oncologists who tend to intervene, no matter what the human costs. Usually they are truthful about defining the small chance of success, but they have not been as forthright about the miserable consequences of chemotherapy. Better to manage the incurable with common sense and compassion. Sometimes the healthcare system is structured to torture the elderly, not because of malevolence, but because of it is a program based on reimbursement rather than what is best for the patient. My 95-year-old mother-in-law gave it her opinion. Sometimes doctors do what isn't needed because Medicare will pay. How's that for insight? Lesson. Sometimes the concepts we think we know so well that have become part of us and automatically part of our consciousness are wrong. We need to change them every so often, not just general social, political, or philosophical concepts, but also at times scientific and medical concepts as well. Otherwise, there will be little or no progress. What happened next? 3 months later, George, the artist, returned for a follow-up examination. He felt he had recovered. His wife gave it her opinion. George is thinking better than ever. My examination confirmed his thinking, memory, and even the subtractions were now not only normal, but superior. He spelled long words backward without any trouble. What had happened? Why and how did George recover? The answer. He stopped the booze. Remove the cause of a disease and you usually get an improvement, and his improvement was dramatic. Fantastic, really. Doc, I'm back to my old self. But what happened to my brain? Can we do another scan? Sorry, George. A repeat scan would be a waste of time and money. It will show no change because the brain can't grow back. How do we know for sure? George, it is so sure the brain can't grow back that I am sure your insurance company will not pay for a repeat scan. Why should they when it is a known fact the brain cannot regenerate? Sure enough, as predicted, the insurance company wouldn't pay for another scan, but the patient himself did pay the $850. Scans were cheaper in those days and money was more valuable. George wanted to see the pictures of his brain again, and he was willing to pay to foot the bill. An attitude consistent with his vocation as a visual artist who felt seeing is believing. Here was a patient who had to know. He had to see it to believe it. And the money meant very little to him, as he was already a multimillionaire thanks to the blue dog paintings. A person's profession can affect how he or she sees things. An architect or a plumber may see the structure and pipes of a building, whereas an artist would be attracted by the building's form. Nazi, the woman who cuts my hair, knows much more about my hair than I do. She takes a professional interest in hair, and in my hair, that I don't. When I see people limping on the street, I can usually tell exactly what is wrong and why they are limping, because appraising gait is a detailed part of the training of all neurologists. Result. George was right. Seeing is believing. If you see something, you believe it. If you don't see it, you don't know. Seeing is believing. But if you don't see it, does that mean it isn't there, and you shouldn't believe it? Aye, there's the rub. It could be there, and you missed it. Or the tools you are using could have been wrong for that particular observation. For instance, if I say there are no bacteria on this paper, and I am using a telescope to look for the bacteria, I will be using the wrong tool, and reaching the wrong conclusion. You can't see bacteria with a telescope. To see bacteria, you need a microscope, not a telescope. There are billions of bacteria on this book, and on your pillow at night. You can't see them, but they are there. The general rule is seeing is believing, and the absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. In other words, if you don't see something, you just don't know. If you just don't know, it is better to suspend judgment until more evidence appears and justifies a conclusion. That way, you will not make the error of believing something not true. Think like a scientist. Demand evidence. Otherwise, don't overexercise the believing parts of your brain. The artist's CAT scan result. The brain is normal as the patient. George's brain, which had been three sizes too small, was now normal in size and shape and internal structure. Why it was normal and why it recovered is another question. He stopped the booze. My opinion is that dose of alcohol each day disturbed protein metabolism in his brain and made the upper brain appear small. But all of the adverse effects of the alcohol must have been reversible, because they did reverse when he stopped drinking. Another possibility was the alcohol had dehydrated the brain, making it appear small because the water content had been reduced. The brain is over 90% water. So a decrease in water content could make the brain appear small. Isn't it remarkable? The human brain, an organ that is mostly water, can do any kind of thinking. An earthquake. The ground shook. The foundation of neurological training at the Great Neurological Institute of New York collapsed in a pile of dust with this personal earthquake. In logic, to disprove a general statement wrong, all that is needed is one true counterexample. For instance, if I say all swans are white, and you show me a black swan, as exists in Russia, then the statement is proven wrong. The statement that the brain never regenerates is proven wrong by one contrary example, demonstrated by George's demand for a repeat scan. More power to him. He taught me a lesson, a great lesson. A lesson that gave me the feeling artists, under some circumstances, can and do teach doctors a great deal. Lesson. The brain, like so many other body organs, just like so many other body tissues, has the potential to recover. Under the right circumstances, it will recover. And in this case, it did recover. It recovered functionally, as evidenced by the artist's mental status examination, and the brain recovered structurally, as evidenced by the repeat CAT scan that was now normal. Lesson. Much of medicine in the old days was unproven conjecture, handed down from professors to students, with no real scientific evidence to back up the conjecture. Instead of science, neurology was a kind of religion based on faith. Whether medicine is still unscientific or not, I don't know. I have a feeling progress has been made, but not that much. Lesson. Absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. If you see it, you may believe it. If you don't see it, you don't know. If you don't know, then suspend judgment. Since then, scans have proven the point time and time again. So we are sure of the fact diseased nervous tissue, given the right circumstances, can recover, regrow, and look normal and be normal. We know that fact for sure because we see it displayed on the scans. Yep, such is the answer for diseased brain tissue. It also raises serious questions about the diagnosis of so-called brain death. To declare a brain is dead because it appears dead begs the question and merely asserts what needs to be proven. When I was an intern at the New York Hospital, I took care of a young woman who had a flatline electroencephalogram, EEG. She had taken a massive overdose of a long-acting barbiturate, secanol. She then changed her mind and called for help. Help arrived just as she slipped into coma and artificial respiration was started immediately. Secanol is also known as secobarbital. The street name is Red Devils, or Reds, because of the orange-red 100-milligram bullet-shaped capsule. The other nickname was Dolls, which was partly responsible for the title of Jacqueline Suzanne's novel, Valley of the Dolls, wherein the major character uses and abuses this drug as many people did in the 1960s to 1970s. Recall, at age 36, Marilyn Monroe, after a life of depression and failed marriages, died of a secanol overdose in 1962. Actress Carol Landis checked out in the same way, probably for the same reasons. Karen's overdose and failed suicide. On admission to the New York Hospital, Karen's electroencephalogram was a flat line. No electrical activity was detected in her brain. And therefore, many of my fellow physicians thought Karen was brain dead. I thought the only thing the flatline EEG proved was there was no detectable brain electrical activity. It didn't prove her brain was dead, because the drug was obviously suppressing the nervous system activity. It was producing coma. Why couldn't a massive blood level of barbiturate also suppress the EEG? So despite the claims I was wasting medical resources, I kept Karen alive by managing electrolytes, controlling infections, feeding her with IVs and a nasogastric tube, and, most importantly, keeping her on a respirator. The human brain requires minute-to-minute supplies of oxygen. If the respirator were turned off, Karen's brain would have died 6 minutes later, and the autopsy would have confirmed brain death. In that case, the autopsy would have appeared to confirm the idea that the flat EEG did, in fact, indicate the brain was dead. Get it? If you don't understand this, reread the paragraph. Pay particular attention to the idea of begging the question. We should not assume something is true, like brain death, unless proven. That the brain appears dead is not proof it is dead. It may just look dead. The EEG in this case was the wrong tool to appraise brain death. Lesson. This is important. Turning off the respirator makes the brain look dead. It doesn't prove the brain was dead before the respirator was turned off. The nurses did a wonderful job turning Karen, cleaning up after incontinence, protecting from bed sores, etc. Without nurses and without my care, Karen would not have had a chance to survive. Over the next 6 weeks, the blood level of barbiturate gradually declined because the liver was metabolizing the drug. Karen awoke and was normal. Yes, normal. Even her EEG was normal. Her grateful father made a donation to the medical center, and Karen and her family thought I was a hero. I'm no hero, Karen. I was just doing my job. You caused me and the nurses lots of extra bloody work. Next time you try to kill yourself, do it right. How about normal brain tissue? But what about normal brain tissue? Can we, by directed medical activity, grow brain tissue to suit a particular need? The answer is yes, yes, yes. Playing the piano for 2 weeks will expand the areas of the brain involved. The London taxicab study showed people studying to be taxi drivers in London increase the size of the brain structure, right parietal lobe, involved in navigation on London roads. Follow-up of our artist patient. George Rodrigue's subsequent career speaks for itself. He went on to produce many famous paintings and he donated much to charities. In June 2008, the New Orleans Museum of Art had a George Rodrigue retrospective that broke the museum's attendance record for an exhibition of work by a living artist. More than 6,000 visitors flocked to the museum during the exhibit's closing weekend on June 7th and 8th, bringing total attendance to 52,813 during the exhibit's 14-week run. Sad to say, this very good artist and very good man died in Houston during the winter of 2013 at age 69. The lung cancer that killed him was caused, in his view, by the chemical sprays he used in his work. It is certain George Rodrigue will get into heaven. All he has to do is offer a blue dog painting to God. Tableau 2. The Old Lady Who Needed a Hug. Bayer College of Medicine. Patient Gertrude. Her name was Gertrude, and she lived in Port Arthur, Texas. She had a problem with a rare disease called myasthenia gravis. When I first saw her in clinic, she was having double vision, trouble talking, chewing, and swallowing, and was feeling weak. Her condition was much better in the mornings when she first got up and got worse as the day wore on. Exercise made her worse and rest made her better. Examination showed the usual for myasthenia. Droopy eyelids, muffled low-pitched voice, easy fatigue of muscles, and so forth. Her condition responded to the usual treatments and she regained her health and returned to normal on minimal amounts of prednisone, the standard treatment for her type of myasthenia. Eventually, the dose of prednisone was reduced to 3 milligrams on alternate days, and she remained in remission for as long as she took that dose. If the dose was reduced to 2 milligrams on alternate days, she had trouble chewing and swallowing, and the fatigue remained. She felt she had been saved from death and wanted to make sure the disease stayed under control. So every year she returned to clinic for a checkup, and after each clinic visit, she would stand up and ask to be hugged. I always hugged her. After all, she was over 80 years old and could have been my grandmother. And, more importantly, she needed a hug. This scenario continued for years until a lecturer from the Texas Medical Board came to talk to us about medical ethics. The board requires every licensed physician in Texas to complete continuing medical education, and part of the requirement involves education about ethics. The lecturer gave it, for his opinion, there should be no personal contact at any time, for any reason, between a physician and the patient. Hugging a patient was strictly unethical and forbidden. Whew! That was news. How strange it was for me to listen to a young man with a background in business administration tell me not to socialize with my patients. When the lecture was over, it was time for questions, and I had one. For the last 30 years, my dentist would repair my teeth in the morning and then take me to his country club and treat me to lunch. What was wrong? At lunch, he and I discussed a long laundry list of our personal and family problems. Is that wrong? On my last visit, my dentist gave me an electric toothbrush. Was that wrong? Report his unethical and very bad behavior to the dental board. Socializing with a patient is highly unethical, as is giving gifts. Having lunch with a patient is a definite no-no. Whoa! Of course, I had no intention to report my dentist friend. The Irish don't rat. You can rely on that. But there is an important issue here about trying to prevent exploitation of patients. The power relations between patient and doctor are sometimes out of balance, and some physicians have used their position to abuse patients. That was not the situation with my dentist friend, nor do I think it was the situation with Gertrude. Per usual, Gertrude returned to clinic for a checkup. She was fine. But at the end of her visit, when she stood for her hug, she was told about the ethics lecture, the medical board, and the new constraints on me, her physician, about hugs. What, no hug? Gertrude asked. I nodded yes. No hug. I can't. It's against the law or something. At this point, my old-mannered Gertrude, my old grandmother-type patient, lost her cool and started shouting. For God's sake, the only reason I come to clinic is for my hug. I'm not leaving until I get my hug. I need a hug. This is ridiculous. Nurses ran into the examining room to find out what the commotion was about. Was Dr. Patten raping an old woman? Gertrude defiantly refuses to leave, and her screaming is upsetting the 50-odd patients in the waiting room. Chaos and commotion. Real-life chaos and commotion, not something engineered by some hack writer of TV melodrama. Shall I make sense or shall I tell the truth? Choose either. You can't have both. I shall not indulge in that primitive storytelling instinct, itself a hangover from religion, to retrospectively impose meaning on real-life chaos. No, no, no. The truth is, Gertrude is going apeshit over a trivial nothing. She is shouting hysterically, simply because she is not getting her usual hug, a hug now forbidden by the exalted Texas Board of Medical Examiners. It is not her fault, and it is not my fault. But there is a problem. Gertrude will not leave the examining room. She won't leave clinic, and she will not stop shouting unless she gets a hug. That's it. Should I call security to remove her, or should I violate the received standard of medical ethics and hug her? To hug or not to hug, that is the question. Reader, I ask you, what would you do? Well, what would you do? What would you do? You, reader, I'm asking you directly. What would you do? I pause for reply. And what do you think I should do? I pause for reply. And what do you think I did? I hugged her, of course, both because she needed it and I needed to get her out of clinic. After over 4 decades in medical practice, I have learned to give the patients what they, within reason, want. Doctor and patient relationships are associated with a certain degree of intimacy. And, I suppose, there is a concern in making a firm distinction between the role of doctor and the role of lover. That is a crude concern. The condition under which Gertrude got her hug is sexually impossible. Her hug belongs to the experience of childhood. I hug her as I would hug my grandmother. With all she and I had been through together, all we had suffered together while she and I were desperately trying to get the myasthenia under control, I was an honorary member of her family. I had saved her life. Saving a life confers privileges, does it not? So I hugged her. So what? No harm done. Gertrude got her hug and left clinic happy and satisfied, while I violated medical ethics and worried someone might rat. It was a mistake for me to take the medical board's prescription as dogma. How could I be so stupid? Lewis Thomas in The Youngest Science comments, "Touching is the oldest and most effective tool in doctoring." For me, this statement rings true. Too bad touching has become perfunctory as the physical examination has grown cursory. Medicine as a science has gone far, but scientific progress does not mandate ignoring those qualities that promote caring. Laying on the hands is necessary, lest medicine lose the close bond between doctor and patient. Sidebar about my image consultant. Talking about touching patients reminded me of John T. Malloy, the image consultant I hired in 1973 to advise me about how to augment my medical practice. Malloy made rounds with me and watched me in clinic. He even stood in the visitors' gallery while I operated, and he interacted with patients and nurses and medical students and residents. After 3 days of observation, during which he took a lot of notes, Malloy went into hiding for a week and came back with 6 single-spaced typed pages of advice. John, cut your hair so you stop looking like a hippie. I was wearing hair hippie style down to my shoulder blades. I got a haircut, and the Houston police stopped stopping my car on the Gulf Freeway and no longer searched the car for drugs. The first month I was in Houston, I had been stopped 4 times. I had a license for any drug they would have found, but the cops didn't know that. John, get rid of the thick glasses. I did, and now wear contacts. I see better, too. John, never wear a bow tie. You look like a clown, and you need a regular tie as a contrast to the neurology department chairman. John, don't loom over patients. When you enter a patient's hospital room, always greet her, touch her, or shake hands, and sit down next to the bed or on the bed itself. This makes you look more human and neutralizes or tends to neutralize the high-tech atmosphere of the hospital. In general, patients are scared stiff and need and want tender, loving care. John, always touch the patient when you see them in clinic or in their room or in the operation room before you cut them up. Touch is human and reassures people, makes them feel safe, and lets them know you care. It is not enough they know they are safe. They have to feel safe, get on the emotional plane, and get off the intellectual plane. Of course, there was lots of other advice which need not concern us here. I paid John $600 and did what he recommended. Within 6 weeks, my practice quadrupled. 2 years later, in 1975, P.H. Wyden published John's best-selling book, Dress for Success. I love old books like this one for their occasional anachronisms, and because the old authors generally are more sensible and much more honest. Take a look at the book and admire John's candor. Back to patient Gertrude. With Gertrude, the situation with repeated ethical violations on each and every clinic visit continued for 3 years. Then Gertrude had a stroke. 3 days after her stroke, she died in St. Elsewhere Hospital in Port Arthur while I was living it up on vacation in Italy at the Grand Hotel in Taormina, sipping an ice-cold Tanqueray martini while overlooking the eternal Ionian Sea that sang its chains, to quote Dylan Thomas. Swells and waves swaying to a not-quite-anapestic beat. Good news and bad news. Gertrude's death was bad news, but her lawyer had good news. Gertrude left her estate to me. Her will said Dr. Patten doesn't know anything about this, but she is leaving everything to me as proof she loves me. The evidence that constituted the proof consisted of her bank account with $105,000, her mortgage-free home, her Steinway D concert grand piano, multiple computers. Gertrude did software reviews for a hobby and for pay, and her personal diary. All assets came to me tax-free as an inheritance, proving hugging a patient can't be all bad. Taking care of Gertrude was my job. But no patient ever thanked me more. But trouble was headed my way, and stupid me didn't even realize how bad that trouble would be. Gertrude's relatives sue Dr. Patten. Gertrude's family contested the will. Not the money, not the house, not the Steinway D concert piano, not the computers, and so forth. The family wanted the diary and only the diary. Their lawyer explained it to me in my office. He had already filed the lawsuit and wanted me to know the family was dead set, pardon the expression, his words not mine. They are dead set about the case. They want her diary. In the evening after dinner, I read the first few pages. Although Gertrude might have been an old bag when she first came to clinic, she had a history. She played the piano for a nightclub and had extracurricular activities connected to the men she met there. Such stuff was not suitable for her relatives to know. If Gertrude would have wanted them to have the diary, she would have willed it to them and not to me. Gertrude left her diary for me to read because, I think, she wanted me to know she had had her fun and her moments of pleasure when she was young, and in her salad days and green in judgment. She wanted me to know that there was a time in her life and in the lives of others during which she raised hell. And she was proud of it. Way to go, Gertrude. Way to go. After reading 10 pages, I started to cry. Gertrude had lived a life well worth living. In clinic, she looked like an old bag, talked like an old bag, and walked like an old bag, because time and fate had kicked her in the face and laid her low, as I expect time will do to me. But the gentlemen she had loved were in her memory. In her diary, she had spit into the face of time that had transfigured her. In clinic, I would never have imagined Gertrude had such a history, but she did. Turn over the diary or don't turn over the diary? That is the question. What would you do, dear reader? Would you return the diary? I asked the question of 6 people. Each said without hesitation they would hand it over to the family. When I asked why, they said, to get out of the lawsuit. When I asked those 6 people what they thought I did, each said they thought I turned the diary over to the family. When I asked why, they said, to get out of the lawsuit. Ignobly faint-hearted, pusillanimous nothings. No guts, no glory. O tempora, O mores, sweet Jesus, I couldn't believe these people were such yellow-bellied cowards. They were afraid of a lawsuit. My creative writing instructor at Rice University even said, I would rather have cancer than a lawsuit. He got his wish. Soon thereafter, he contracted and died of acute leukemia. Never talk like that. It tempts the gods. What I did with the diary. Discretion is the better part of valor, to quote Falstaff. So I took the better part. I took the diary to the edge of my backyard and burned it. Burned the diary, that is, not the backyard. The family was out of luck. They were never going to get the diary because the diary no longer existed. Even if they won the lawsuit, they couldn't recover the diary. There are distinct limits to the justice system. In most lawsuits, almost anything can happen, including nothing, as was the case here. Result? The lawyer withdrew, and that was that. Lesson. Hug them. Lesson. No guts, no glory. As stated, Gertrude had her stroke while I was on vacation in Italy. That reminds me of the experiences Ethel and I had during vacation. 2 Italian men. Once 2 items are associated in the consciousness, each tends to recall the other, in the order first presented. Here, the mention of Gertrude's stroke while I was at the hotel in Taormina triggered a memory of Italy and 2 Italian men. So the problem with this narrative is now, whether I should try to keep to some kind of order, chronological or logical, topical or whatnot, or like Proust, just follow the patterns of my thoughts and tell and not tell as my spirit sees fit. There are a million ways of telling a story. You know there are. Others have their ways, and I have mine. The reason I write like this is the kind of thing I like to read. Not having seen this kind of stuff elsewhere, I create it for my own enjoyment, and I hope for your enjoyment and the enjoyment of others. At Leisure in Italy. Taormina is a small town on the east coast of the island of Sicily, Italy. It is in the province of Messina, and about midway between Catania and Messina, on the Ionian Sea, which, by the way, is warm with nice beaches. The majestic Grand Hotel Taormina stands on a cliff overlooking the hotel's private beach, and there was a nice garden and pool by the edge of the cliff and an aerial tramway that led down to the water. Whether the Grand Hotel Taormina still exists or not, and if it does exist, whether it still has a tramway and private beach, I don't know and I don't care, and I am too lazy to look it up. The hotel's present existence is not relevant. This story is about a past adventure that happened there. At the time of the appearance of Italian Man 1, the hotel and Taormina were very popular tourist attractions. That is why Ethel and I were there. A strange interlude. One night, just as I sat down to dinner in the main dining area, the head waiter came to our table and asked if he could speak with me. Yes, of course. I want to fight you for your wife. I am in love with her. I was sympathetic. Ethel is very lovable, and men do fall in love with her, though not a word is spoken. Me. Fight? Okay, but may I finish my dinner? He. Of course. Meet me at 9:30 tonight in the garden by the pool, and we will fight. Okay, 9:30 in the garden. Ethel was amused by this. So was I. Ethel was always beautiful and sexy, so I could understand this guy's attitude. But surely he was joking, and we continued our dinner thinking that his was a highly amusing joke. Our amusement turned to chagrin when we arrived at the garden and saw the head waiter waiting. He was serious, and as he removed his jacket, he told me to get ready. Okay. I looked him straight in the eyes and pointed my finger at his chest. Before we start, I need to tell you, in the United States, I am considered a trained prize fighter. My trainer was my Uncle Tom, who was the middleweight champion of Queens, New York. If we fight, it is possible I will kill you. Now the chagrin was his. He paused, developed a long face, a kiss pout like a child rejecting the breast, wrinkled his brow, and announced with a shrug, "You can have her." He left. And that was that. Lesson. The best battles are the ones you win without going toe to toe. Italian Man 2. 2 weeks later, we were in Ischia, the volcanic island in the Tyrrhenian Sea. It lies at the northern end of the Gulf of Naples and is situated northwest of Capri, which is better known, but not as nice. The main industry in Ischia is tourism centered around the thermal spas, and that is why Ethel and I were there. In the mornings, Ethel and I would take breakfast on the veranda overlooking the pool and gardens of the Grand Hotel Ischia. From the first breakfast on, we became aware of a young man, Italian Man 2. Italian Man 1 was the head waiter, staring at us. He stood leaning on a tree about 20 feet from the veranda and stayed there looking at us until our breakfast was over. He was an Adonis with curly blonde hair and a fit body. When we left our table, he left his position and went I know not where. In the afternoons, he was at the entrance to the hotel and followed us wherever we went. In the evenings, there was a carnival in town, and Ethel and I would walk to town to enjoy the sights and sounds of carnival. He followed us into town. He followed us around the carnival. He watched me win and lose at the games. And he followed us back to the hotel. In more modern times, he would have been considered a stalker. Come to think on it, he was a stalker. But in those days, society didn't have a word for his behavior. We just thought he was a follower, and we couldn't think of a reason to stop him, and we couldn't think of a way to stop him. Our young follower stalked us for 3 more days and nights. On day 4, Ethel went inside the hotel to answer a telephone call. I stayed at poolside, reading a book about the history of sex, a very interesting book about the history of sex in different cultures at different times. The varieties of sexual expression throughout history are enormous. It is a very good book. I recommend it for those few of you who might be interested in sex. Title, Sex in History by Ray Tannehill, Stein and Day. Also by the same author, Food in History, and another book, Flesh and Blood, A History of the Cannibal Complex. Back to poolside, as a deep, dark shadow passes over the history of sex. I look up. The stalker is there looming over me, blocking the sunlight and interfering with my reading, just when I was getting into tantric. He smiles and speaks. I suppose you noticed I have been following you. Do you understand my English? Pretty good English. You do have a slight Italian accent, but I understand you. And yes, we have noticed you have been following us. And I suppose you know what I want. Yes, I do. You want to fight me for my wife. No, I'm in love with you. I thanked him and explained I wasn't that kind of man. He got the long face, bowed out, and left. We didn't see him again. Ethel was amused and thought it was about time someone in Italy, besides herself, was the sex object. I suppose the human race is doing the best it can under the circumstances, but hell's bells, that's only an explanation, not an excuse. Lesson. Italy is a different country. They do things differently there. Tableau 3. 2 very sick people and 1 not as sick administrator. Bayer College of Medicine. Patients Ruth Heilbach, Penny Bailey, and a Medicare administrator. Gertrude had myasthenia, reminding me of some other patients with myasthenia, many of whom were very sick. For instance, Ruth Heilbach spent months on a respirator. She became unable to chew, swallow, or talk. Soon thereafter, she was unable to move a single muscle. People who came into her room saw a body lying there, still as a stone, except for the up and down chest movements caused by the respirator. Ruth's disease did not respond to any of the usual treatments, so I decided to try an experiment. Myasthenia is caused by antibodies attacking the connection between the nerves and the muscles. So the treatments are directed against the antibodies that are attacking. Ruth had her thymus removed in the hope that would stop the antibodies. It did not. She had taken a host of medicines to stop antibody production. That didn't work either. In fact, there were no other known ways of hitting this disease. So what do you do if you don't know what to do? Answer, you analyze the situation and act accordingly. The human spleen is a lymphoid organ harboring antibody-producing cells. So I decided it might be a good idea to remove Ruth's spleen to see what would happen. No committees were involved in this decision. No permission was given by anyone to me to do or try such a thing. In those days, the doctor and the patient just decided what to do, and that was that. The doctor is in charge. I was running the show. However, it would have been nice to get Ruth's permission. But Ruth was in no condition to give permission. She could not move a single muscle. The only way people knew she was alive was her pupils responded to light and her heart was still beating. Her mother. Ruth wants you to do anything you want, but I can't give permission for the operation because I don't want the responsibility. You're joking. You just told me Ruth wants to do anything. You're just giving me the permission she gave you to give me. You are her proxy. Ruth is giving permission through you. Ruth's mother shook her head and started to cry. I can't do it. If she dies, I would never forgive myself. You have to act on your own. So, I guess the removal of spleen will proceed with a kind of informal verbal consent transferred from the patient to the patient's mother to me. At this time, Ruth herself is too sick to communicate anything. Informed consent in this case is impossible. Informed consent is overrated anyway. Is there such a thing? If someone told you everything that might happen when you drive your car to the movies, they would probably spend all day and all night and still not cover all the possible adverse events. In fact, informed consent, or the attempt to get fully informed consent, can have complications as severe as any medical treatment or operation. Two examples will appear in this narrative in due time. Stanley Crawford, my surgeon friend, agreed to remove the spleen on my say-so, but when he and his resident visited the room, they thought Ruth was already dead. Imagine how frightening it must have been for poor Ruth to have some surgeons hovering over her and saying absurd things like, "This patient is dead. Bernie must not know she's dead." Stanley and his resident were surprised when I showed them Ruth's pupils contracted to light. "She is alive all right, just in very bad shape." "Ruth," I shouted, "don't pay any attention to these jerks. They are surgeons. They don't know anything about myasthenia." Stanley chimed in. "I don't even know how to say it, much less what it's about. But if Bernie wants your spleen out, we can do that, no question." "Ruth, I want them to cut out your spleen because I think that will help. There is some evidence, well, not really evidence, conjecture really, my idea really, that the spleen has cells in it making antibodies that are making you weak. So taking out your spleen should help, and if it doesn't, we'll try something else. Okay? And if that doesn't work, we will try something else. We'll keep trying. We will never give up. I will never give up. Okay? Ruth, I know you can't tell me yes or no, so I am assuming you would say yes if you could say anything. Tomorrow they will take you to the operating room, and I will stand by to make sure you are okay before, during, and after the operation. I'm not worried about you. You are strong in spirit. You will survive this illness. You will get back in shape by sheer strength of will and the power of my medicine. Notice, even when the condition is perilous, I focus on encouraging elements by indulging in Pollyannish cant. Faith and optimism have life-giving qualities. Some patients recover health just on faith in the doctor. Faith comes from trust and is a critical aspect of healing. Optimism is a patent moral imperative, and, for the physician whose role is to affirm life, a medical imperative. Even when the outlook is grim, affirmative action and words promote well-being and shift the odds in favor of recovery. The major problem in the present litigious age is an innovative approach can fail. And the consequences are likely to be far worse if the procedure is novel and untested or not approved. Fear of lawsuits makes physicians hesitant, circumspect, and as a result, often ineffective in cases where the patient is seriously ill and needs special innovative treatment. The danger. Operating on a myasthenic patient is hazardous, and operating on a patient like Ruth, who was in terrible shape, is even more hazardous. In the operating room, the bravest person would, of course, be Ruth. But what would you do? Sometimes a cliché is essential in understanding my vision. I had to carry the fight within the jaws of death itself. It was either continue to fight or give up. Tell me, did I do the right thing? Would you, in my place, have removed Ruth's spleen on the outside chance removal would solve her problem? Would you have dared? Would you have had the guts? Would you have acted without any formal legal permission? I pause for reply. Pepit, you cannot say or guess, for you don't know. The comparative method is absurd. To think too much is to think too much. You cannot expect to measure the value of Ruth's life as though it were stock in a warehouse. My job was to help her survive, and by God, that is what I would do, and do it not as a stranger. If our situations were reversed and Ruth were my doctor and I her patient, I would want Ruth to take out my spleen as a last-ditch, desperate effort to cure my disease. Furthermore, if Ruth were my doctor, I would want her to treat me as I were treating her, not as a stranger, but as a friend. What happened? Next day, Ruth is post-op. Ruth's mother met me outside the operating room. How is she? She asked. I'm encouraged, I said, positively gleeful. Why? Well, for one thing, she's still alive. That's a miracle. And the spleen is out. It was larger than normal. The surgeons have removed several billion of the cells, making Ruth sick. Will she recover? I hope so, but I don't know. I don't have a crystal ball. I can't predict the future. Result. 2 weeks after the spleen had been removed, Ruth was able to breathe on her own. And 2 weeks after, she was walking and talking. Ruth spent decades as a painter of beautiful pictures and made her living as a commercial artist. She is the star of the movie.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.